check.
Hello. Yes, friends, I'm back. The live session. Okay. Now, there is some of the important branches of biology. Or the ABC of biology. A for anatomy. What is anatomy? You know, it is internal structure of a particular organism. And the other A is for B for botany, study of plants. You know, the father of botany is Theophrastus. Then, biology is related with the chemistry. So, yet another B, that is biochemistry. Another B, that is bacteriology, study of bacteria. C in biology is cytology. Study of cells. D in biology stands for dendrology. What is dendrology? Study of trees. E stands for embryology. Study of embryo development. And E stands for ecology. Study of interactions between the organisms and with the environment. E stands for entomology. Entomology is study about insects. Then G for genetics. Study of heredity and variation. You have learned this aspect in your 10th class. H for histology. What is histology? Study of tissues. Histo refers to tissues. Histology, study of tissues. Then another H, that is herpetology. Herpetology is study of snakes. I in biology stands for ichthyology. What is ichthyology? Study of snakes. M stands for mycology. Mycology refers to study of a fungus. Microbiology. Study of microorganisms. P stands for phycology, that is study of algae. Phyco means algae, so study of algae. And P stands for paleontology. Paleontology is study of fossils. Again, in your 10th class, you have learned about fossils in evolution chapter. And pomology. Pomology is study of fruits. Parasitology, study of parasites living in the body of the organism. T for taxonomy, classification of organisms. V, virology. Virology is study of virus. And the last, Z refers to zoology. Zoology is study of zoans, that means animals. Father of zoology is Aristotle. So father of biology, Aristotle, and father of zoology, Aristotle. And father of botany, Theophrastus. So these are some of the basic concepts. Innumerable number of branches are in your hand. You can opt any of these branches for your specialization. Now we are going to the first chapter in that is the living world. And in this chapter, we will learn about what is living. That means the different characteristics of living organisms. Then about the taxonomy, taxonomic hierarchy, and taxonomic aids. So after learning these concepts, you must be able to identify some of the plants. You must be able to identify some of these animals, and you will develop a passion to identify these different organisms present in the nature. Coming to the first content, what is living, or what are the characteristics of living organisms? The first and the foremost character is growth and development. You know what is growth? It is an irreversible increase in size, in the weight, in the volume of the body. And why this size increases? You know, once you were a very small single cell, that is the zygote, and from that zygote changes into multicellular embryo, then fetus, then the newborn baby, and now after your schooling, after this primary, then you came to secondary, now you are in 11th class, going to take the admission in 11th class. So consider the change, growth. From a single cell zygote, you reached into this multicellular and well-grown child. So growth, it is an irreversible change. Can you go back to the single cell zygote? No, not at all. Now, what are the difference between this growth in the case of plants and animals? In plants, you know, the growth is continuous. Whenever you are observing a plant, it grows very continuously. You might have seen a seed, then it sprouts, produces a tiny plant, and from the tiny plant, a tall tree is formed. So that means the growth is continuous. And why this growth is continuous in the case of plants? That is a very amazing question here. Because it possesses a group of actively dividing cells, that is meristem. You have learned this concept in your 9th class, different types of meristem. And what is meristem? Then, now in the case of an animal, the growth is limited. It is limited for a certain stage only. Up to a certain age, there is growth. After that, there won't be any growth. However, now some of you will ask, why there is increase in size when we are putting this dried grapes, that is resins, in water? It will also absorb water and swells up. Size increases, volume increases. So whether it is a growth? No, not at all. It is not a growth. Because for growth, there needs so many chemical reactions, so many molecules are needed, and after that, some new molecules are synthesized, new cells are formed, cytoplasm is formed, and new cells are formed, tissues are formed, size increases. So such a type of, and for all these, there needs energy in the form of ATP. So this type of a complex structure, and this type of utilization of energy, that is not there in this particular case. So it is not at all a growth. Then here you can see the growth of a bean plant, a pulses, a pulse that is growing, germinated and undergoing different stages of growth, that you can see And similarly, the life cycle of a butterfly also you can see. From egg, it passes through different stages of growth and becomes a mature butterfly. Metamorphosis, we will say this phenomenon as metamorphosis. Now, the next character, that is reproduction. You know the term, we can divide this term into two, reproduction. Re means dwara. Reproduction. Particular organism that is producing its own same copy. Again. So, production of young ones of a same kind by an organism. That is reproduction. And why it is needed? To continue the same species. Otherwise, that particular organism will finish after the completion of one particular generation. And you might have learned about the different types of reproduction here. Asexual and sexual. Asexual. And the other is sexual reproduction. And asexual reproduction, there is no need for any of these sex organs. No fusion of gamete, no zygote formation, fertilization, no embryo formation. And all the progeny will remain the same. So such type of reproduction that is made present in organisms, the primitive type of organisms, algae, fungi, yeast, hydra and all. So here, there are different methods in these organisms. In the case of fungi, it reproduces by spores. Small spherical structures are produced inside a sac-like structure. That sac-like structure is known as sporangium. And in that sporangium, there present the spores. And these spores will, after maturity, it will give rise to new organism. Then in yeast and hydra, you know what is the method of reproduction? It is budding. A small lateral projection that comes out from the parental body. It grows, it enlarges, and it will get detached from the parental body and give rise to new organism. Then, in the case of a planaria, it is known as regeneration. Re means dwara, generate una. So, the lost part, if we are cutting this planaria into two equal half, it will give rise to new organism. So, here you can see this diagram also. We are cutting this organism into three pieces. All the three pieces. That develops into new organism. Three new organisms are formed. In the hydra, you can see the, and in hydra also you can see this phenomenon. What is this phenomenon? Regeneration. So hydra reproduces even by regeneration also. Regeneration, at another new term is neogenesis. Genesis means formation. Neogenesis means dwara naya portion banna hai. So the lost the part that is developing again. So these are the points. Then there are certain organisms, they are sterile, not able to reproduce. Sterile means not able to reproduce. Examples: mule, that is, and worker honeybees. All these are sterile organisms. Now, another important character is metabolism. Metabolism, that means the a living organism is a biochemical factory. That means there are so many reactions, chemical reactions are going on. You are unaware of that aspect. When you are walking, when you are sleeping, and every time there occurs different types of chemical reactions that are going on in your body. And that biochemical reactions, that is known as metabolic pathway or metabolism. So different molecules, for example, fat, proteins, DNA, RNA, all these molecules are interacting and they are producing new molecules, and they assemble together and forms new and new tissues, organs, organ systems and organism. Then when we are analyzing this metabolism, there are two different types of reaction. One is catabolism and the other is anabolism. Now, what is catabolism and what is anabolism? A very important concept, very important question for your exam also. And it is a simple mechanism. You can correlate by some of these abbreviations. So how will you differentiate these two phenomena, catabolism and anabolism? So catabolism, you know, catastrophe. What is catastrophe? Danger, damage, destruction. So catabolism is destruction. So you can use the abbreviation CD. CD, you know, CD. In a computer, you are using CD. So that term CD. So, but that is a compact disc. One either. Here you are correlating it as C for catabolism, D for destruction. So it is a destructive process. And coming to anabolism, it is constructive. So there you can correlate as AC, A for anabolism and C for construction. You know AC. You are using AC in your home. And in school we are saying your AC madam is coming, AC is coming. So AC, you are familiar with that term. So anabolism and constructive. So anabolism means constructive process. Why I am emphasizing these two aspects? Because most of the children, they will write the things in a reverse manner, opposite manner. You know, but ulta ho gaya. So catabolism is destructive process, CD. Anabolism is constructive process, synthetic process. And when you are destructing something, what you are getting is, for example, किसी को मकान तोड़ना है तो इट इज अ कॉम्प्लेक्स स्ट्रक्चर. सो कॉम्प्लेक्स स्ट्रक्चर इज यूज्ड इन द केस ऑफ कैटाबॉलिज्म. एंड व्हाट यू आर गेटिंग इन दैट वन, सिंपल मॉलिक्यूल्स. अगर कॉम्प्लेक्स बिल्डिंग दिया तो यू विल गेट ब्रिक्स, सिंपल मॉलिक्यूल्स आ गया. सो कॉम्प्लेक्स मॉलिक्यूल्स आर यूज्ड एंड यू आर गेटिंग सिंपल मॉलिक्यूल्स. सो इन दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रोसेस energy is released. And can you give an example of such a process that is going on in your body? There are so many processes. One is respiration. And in respiration, you know, glucose, that is converted into carbon dioxide and water, releasing energy. So it is a typical example of catabolism. Now coming to anabolism, constructive process. I have already told you, for construction we are using simple molecules. So simple molecules are used, and by using those simple molecules we can make a complex molecule. Complex molecules are produced, and for making simple to complex we need energy. So energy is used, energy is consumed. And example, photosynthesis is a typical example of anabolism, constructive process. There we are using carbon dioxide, water, sunlight and chlorophyll. These are simple molecules. We are assembling all these molecules and we are making glucose first, then starch and other products. So this is an important question. differences between catabolism and anabolism. Now, another important character, that is cellular organization. You know what is a cell? Yes. Cell is the structural and functional unit of an organism. You have learned this definition from class 6 onwards. For the function of the body, the basic cell is new, and that unit is known as. And you know who discovered a cell? Yes, Robert Hooke, from the plant cork tree, Corcus zuber. So he took thin sections of the cork, observed under his simple assorted microscope, observed honeycomb like structure, and he called it as cellulae. You all know these aspects, learned in your 9th class, 8th class, like that. So now, based on these number of cells, we can divide the organisms into two categories. What are they? And you know the thing, if it contains, if an organism contains only one cell, it is unicellular organism. Example, bacteria, then all the monerans, protozoans, all are coming under this category. And second is multicellular, very good. That means many cells, multi means many, many cells are present in the body of the organism. Almost all the higher plants, animals, higher animals, all are multicellular with body made up of many cells. Oh, now what is this advantage? In unicellular organism, all the work has to be done by that single cell. But in multicellular organisms, different cells will perform different function. For example, brain cells will form the, or nervous cells, they will form the system, doing the conduction of a stimulus, messages. And liver cells, hepatic cells, they are doing the for detoxification and related metabolic activities. So there are different types of cells doing different functions, and they will form different organs, and they are well differentiated, and they are different in their size, shape, structure, position and function. So this aspect, that means division of labor, different teachers are teaching you different subjects. Principal is doing at another work. Office staff is doing at another work. So division of labor. Then next character of a living organism, that is response to stimuli. What is a stimulus? If there occurs any change in the environment that makes your body to react, that is known as stimulus. For example, temperature badh gaya, both extreme temperature aa gaya, so what happens is excessive sweating, or severe thand aa gaya, so shivering. So that means there is variation in the environment. So these variations, any type of a change that takes place in your surroundings, that will make you to act, react. So that is what is called as a stimulus. And that reaction of the body, of the organism, in response to that particular stimulus, that is what we call as response. The organism is responding. How the organism is responding to temperature change? If the temperature increases, then there occurs excessive sweating in animals, and in plants there occurs wilting. And if decreasing, then there occurs shivering. By shivering, there produces more and more energy, heat. So protect body from the low temperature. Then plants are showing some of the response to light. You may know about this aspect, that is known as phototropism. That's response of plants towards light. You might have seen in most of these biology lab, for decoration, we are keeping some of the plants near to the window. And when you are seeing after some 1 week or 2 weeks, this plant is bending towards the window, towards the light. So this is the phenomenon that is phototropism. The plant will bend or grows towards the light stimulus. And another important character that is shown by all these living organisms, that is consciousness. We are conscious about each and every activities that are going on in our surroundings. We have the feeling to smell all these changes. And finally, the character that is evolution, change. Here you can see in this diagram, the plant that is bending towards light source. So this is showing what? Which phenomenon? Phototropism. The plant is moving towards the light. Phototropism. Which part is moving towards light? Shoot system. And what are the roots growing downwards? Towards gravity. Now, here you can see innumerable number of organisms. Variety of organisms, and it includes plants, then animals, different types of animals. So many aspects, so many organisms you can see here, and we can call all these together as biodiversity. So what is biodiversity? Different, diverse means different. Different types of organisms present in the earth surface. That is known as biodiversity. And what are the different types of plants? Organisms, that is plants, animals, and microbes. So a rough estimate of this biodiversity is 1.7 to 1.8 million species. And one of these ecologists, that is Edward Wilson, introduced the term biodiversity. Here also you can see a pictorial representation of this biodiversity with the different types of organisms. Now coming to this nomenclature, name, your parents have given you a beautiful name. When you were a child, they might have given you a cute name, Munna, Munni, whatever it may be. So after that, when you are joining to the school, you will get at another name. So that means some localities, common for one particular species, one particular organism. But in the another locality, that name is a different one. It will be yet another name for the same organism. Then in the third locality, again the same organism is having a... So identification becomes a very headache. So how to minimize? So there is a local name or common name for each and every organism. And it will vary from people to people, locality to locality, place to place. It varies. So the disadvantage of using common name is difficulty to identify the organism. So for identifying the organism clearly, there needs a common name. So that common name, that means a standardized name. That standardized name means it is well identified. If you are to any will remains the same. That name, standard name, will remain the same. इसलिए उसको standard name ही कहते हैं. So that term that we are calling it as nomenclature. Nomen means naming. Naming an organism by giving a standard name. Why to give a standard name? Because it will remain the same all over the world. So it is known as standard name, nomenclature. Now, coming to identification. Suppose on the way you have seen one particular snake. On the next day you came to the school and talked to your biology teacher. This is the size, this is the color, this was the length, every aspect you are saying. So that means you are observed the organism minutely and correctly. So that is about a detailed observation of a particular organism. That is what is called as identification. Now, how these naming has to be given, or what are the organs or the authorities meant for giving nomenclature naming? So for plants, there is at another organization for giving the name, that is ICBN. ICBN, all capital letters. Very important abbreviation question for your exam. I for international, C for code, the international code of nomenclature. Name the, if it is animal, it is an international code of zoological nomenclature, that is ICZN. Then suppose it is a virus, there is at another organization ICVN, international code for viral nomenclature. And for cultivated plants, it is ICNCP, International Code of Nomenclature for Cultivated Plants. So, in your textbook, it is only these two aspects mentioned. One is ICBN and ICZN, International Code of Botanical Nomenclature, and the other is International Code of Zoological Nomenclature. So ICBN and ICZN are the two main organizations that is meant for giving names to the standard names. Scientific name. Next concept coming here is scientific name. So that is scientific name, or otherwise known as binomial name. Binomial nomenclature. Nomenclature means naming. Binomial means, bi means two. Binomial means naming an organism by giving two names. One is genus name. The other is species name. In your textbook, the species name is written as specific epithet. So two names, genus name and species name, is given to a particular organism. And this naming is based on some of these specific principles, rules, criteria. And who is the father of this binomial nomenclature? That is Carolus Linnaeus. Carolus Linnaeus, known as father of binomial nomenclature. Now, I give some of the examples. Mangifera indica. ये क्या है? मैंगो ट्री. सो मैंजिफेरा इंडिका, व्हेन यू आर ऑब्जर्विंग देयर आर टू नेम्स. फर्स्ट नेम इज जीनस मैंजिफेरा, देन सेकंड इज इंडिका. स्पीशीज नेम स्पेसिफिक एपिथेट. सो टू नेम्स, वन इज मैंजिफेरा, द अदर इज इंडिका. सो मैंजिफेरा इज जीनस नेम एंड इंडिका इज. So like this, there are different examples of a binomial nomenclature. The remaining aspects we will go through in the next second in the session. So I think you all enjoyed the session. If you have any doubts, you can comment and go through the textbook, read the chapter, read each and every line, each and every page. Slowly and steadily you can learn biology. Be positive, think positive, stay at home, stay safe and stay healthy.